Can I encourage anyone who's kind of sitting in the periphery to kind of join us? So perhaps, I know those are really comfortable chairs there. Maybe one of you place those and bring them forward, place these two, bring them forward, that you kind of... So I want to welcome everyone tonight. Thank you very much for coming to this event. Artist Platforms, Diaspora and Transnational Exchange in the Digital Age, an event organised with Future Assembly, and you'll find out all about Future Assembly presently. My name is Paul Goodwin. I'm a curator and I'm director of the Transnational Art Identity and Nation Research Centre here at the University of the Arts at Chelsea. And TRAIN is a community of researchers, postgraduate students, and associated members of the University of the Arts, basically doing interdisciplinary research into art and design. But the main focus of our work, which I think is pertinent to discussion today, is how artworks, if you like, are invested in questions of identity and nation in a transnational context. That's what we investigate across various disciplines. So we have artists who are part of the project, are part of our centre. We have curators, we have art historians, and we have design historians as well. And we also work across various disciplines, including architecture. So that's kind of what TRAIN is. It's a cross University of the Arts initiative. We're based here at Chelsea College of Arts. We're sitting here in the green room, which is one of our grand rooms. This, of course, was an old naval college. So it has that kind of historic background. You're sitting here in front of a portrait by an alumni of Chelsea, Chris Freely, a work that he produced when he was a student at Chelsea, which is actually on loan to our collection. And so he's kind of giving us the eye as we continue our deliberations. You know, it's quite interesting just to point that out. So there is a toilet downstairs that we need to kind of, at any point, visit the toilet. Downstairs, you go through the door downstairs. There's also a screening of Beyonce's Lemonade, but you're not allowed to take it because we need you here. You'll also get that online, I'm sure. So we're going to talk today about the value and the nature of artist platforms within the context of transnational exchange, and of course the role of the digital in that. And there are a number of artists that are joining us, of course, Future Assembly. All are going to introduce in a second. We will introduce the artists. We're going to have a conversation. The artists are going to present some of their work, and there were a number of questions that Paula will outline that we wanted to discuss. But I thought it might be an idea, because we've got quite an intimate crowd and quite an interesting crowd, lots of new news in the room, many people who've got lots of experience in working in these kinds of transnational networks. So if I may, I'd like to just quickly go around the room just to say who we are and what we do. Just really quickly, I just think it might help to situate, you know, relate to the conversation. And we want to keep this, while we've set it up like this, having in this room, we want to keep it in a very kind of open, informal mode, okay? It's not like we're just talking at you. So there will be a presentation to kind of open up the discussion, and then we really basically about getting involved, and please raise your hand, and I will be kind of pointing people out and getting people to start. So if I can ask Evan to really kick off, as is, you know.
Right, okay. So hi, I'm Evan, I'm an artist, working mostly in performance, video, and these various aspects of kind of participatory practices. I'm Paula,
fantastic.
London, but I work for a research charity now. It's called Passage, it's in Victoria. So I'm doing full time, I struggle to make work.
I'm Jeff, I'm a painter from Los Angeles.
I'm Eve, I'm a master's student at SOAS.
I'm Alessio, I'm the director of Gasworks and the Triangle Network.
I'm Joel, I'm the program's coordinator at Gasworks.
I'm Pierre, I'm currently hosting the Logo show and use the world in depth with the hands here in the world.
Les Morgan, when I was based in Melbourne.
My name is Logo Oluwamuyiwa. I'm a photographer. I live and work in Lagos, Nigeria. I'll tell you what I want to mention.
I just want to point out one thing. This event is being recorded, which will go on to Future Assembly's website and also the Trained website. So, does anyone have any issues about being recorded? Film, if you do, let's work it out. But I just wanted to point that out. So, let me now quickly introduce our co-director of Future Assembly, Orla Houston-Dubra, who's a curator, creative content producer and arts communication specialist. She was head of publicity and partnerships at Tintin Hudson. Before that, worked as assistant curator and project manager at the Victoria Museum, and a range of exhibitions and events. Including fantastic events. No, I'll mention some of them because it helps us situate the conversation in the situation we do. Figures and fiction, contemporary and surrounding photography, which I actually know is part of the seminar, so it's a person with that. The Fabric of India, and also Friday Late at Oxford, and Friday Late at Politics.
Yeah.
And the Lates, anyone been to the Lates at V&A? They're pretty good, so there you go. Orla was a graduate, as Hansi was, of the Royal College of Arts Curated Contemporary Art main program, and also has an MA in Art History from Porto Institute. So let me hand over to Orla, who will give you a context of Future Assembly, who are the co-organizers of this event tonight, hosted by Train, and she will explain a little bit about the artist practice. Thank you, Orla.
Thank you very much, Paul, and thank you to Train for hosting us tonight. Really appreciate all your support. Also, really quickly like to thank the African Artists Foundation, who we've worked with, and Arts Council of India, who have very generously funded Future Assembly. And also, thank you to all of you for coming tonight. As Paul said, really hope to have a really broad discussion and for you all to get really involved and to feel like it's your event as much as ours. So, to take note about Future Assembly, Future Assembly is a London-based platform for young artists from Africa and its diaspora that has been designed or founded to allow space for experimentation and peer-to-peer learning for younger emerging new practitioners, new visual art practitioners. As Hansi mentioned, she conceived the project originally, and she and I co-curated this first session together. So each session focuses on one artist who takes part, comes to London for a bespoke 4-week residency. We're in the middle of session one at the moment, which is our pilot, our first session, and Ligor is the he's the lucky guy. He's come over to London to work with us. So he's been busy out on gallery visits, researching, doing all kinds of manner of practical and kind of critical sessions, which are hopefully valuable to him in developing his practice. And we are also in the middle, as Pierre mentioned, of a solo exhibition which we curated of Lavoie's work. It's called It's Also a Solo Journey, and it's on at News of the World Gallery in Deptford until the 22nd of May. So if you have a chance to, please do pop along and visit. As I mentioned, Future Assembly is an initiative concerned for Igbo artists and artistic communities from the African continent and the diaspora. The opportunity to develop their networks, and also it's a mutually beneficial thing, hopefully, is the idea that artists here from, you know, whatever part of the kind of artistic community they are from, it's an opportunity for them to expand their network with artists from the continent. This evening with train is a really crucial part of what we're trying to do. And we're really hoping that it'll be kind of a meaningful, thought-provoking conversation. And I see it as a kind of chance to consider with all of you some of the kind of pertinent questions that Hansi and I have been asking ourselves in the process of developing Future Assembly Session 1. So some of those questions are, how are relationships between African and African diaspora artists and audiences shifting in the globalised art world? What are the new productive spaces for creative practices in relation to production and co-production, and how can online platform and public spaces facilitate these? And how do real world and online artist platforms and networks facilitate transnational exchange? So I really wanted to think about collective collaboration and identify some successful models, particularly those facilitating intra-continental interaction. Explore or touch upon some of the new aesthetic and discursive spaces that are opening up for artists. Again, primarily looking at artists from the African continent and in the diaspora, but if anyone has experience with kind of any other regions, including the UK, please, you know, contribute those thoughts and that experience as well. I'd like us to think about the impact of the shift away from identity within kind of visual arts discourse towards effect, relationality, and a global context, and how that has impacted upon continental African artists. I want us to consider whether artist-led platforms, particularly online, offer a way of negating the priorities and expectations that are often placed upon African and African diaspora artists, and highlight tensions between individualism and collectivism that contemporary practitioners can experience. So I just wanted to mention in some of the kind of reading I've been doing ahead of this evening, I reread something that Kodwo Eshon wrote in 2007 in response to the Venice Biennale when they had an African pavilion. And he wrote about the painfully restricted spaces practitioners are still obliged to inhabit in order to create platforms through which the complexities of African contemporaneity become visible, audible, and speakable. So I'm really interested to know if we all think that's still the case, if positioning oneself is still kind of part of the day-to-day business of artists of African heritage, and if platforms and networks are a necessary way of kind of carving out space for themselves, or whether as a kind of critic and educator called Boy Ashraf Jamal, who I was reading over on the Contemporary And website recently. He said last year, the art world has become polycentric, a loose network of overlapping subcultures held together by belief in art. It is within this more malleable context that we can now measure the growing impact of contemporary African art. So it'd be interesting to see what you all think, and the three artists who you've invited to speak tonight feel that they sit in between those two positions, if they do at all. So at this point, I'd like to hand over to the artists. I will briefly introduce them all. And apologies to everyone, including primarily artists, for my horrible pronunciation Oh, one other thing I wanted to apologise for. Well, for apologies. I had a complete, my laptop chose this morning to break down, so I had to put this slideshow together in the internet cafe. So if it looks less than perfect, forgive me. Okay, so we'll start with Logo. So Logo Oluwamuyiwa. You mentioned he's a Lagos-based photographer, exploring documentary and more conceptual modes. He draws his inspiration from history, photography, poetry, and daily life in Lagos. His first major project, Monochrome Lagos, is a reflection on city life that strips away the vivid colours that the metropolis is known for. I don't know how many of you are familiar with Lagos, but that's the kind of the key trope of the city. And he presents a first fresh perspective through portraiture and landscape photography. Monochrome Lagos is a digital archive that he shares through his Tumblr platform. And he has previously exhibited in group exhibitions in Lagos. Next to Logo is Apo Junior Boakye-Yiadom, who's a British Canadian artist, born and living in London. Interesting, he's already said to make himself, but I'll also say that he's interested in creating dialogue in a collaborative manner with mediums, materials, and creative practitioners. He has a multimedia artistic practice, creates hybrid installations where sculpture, photography, sound, and the moving image are materialised. Both archival and self-produced, and kinetically combined to form a language of connectivity and multiplicity. He has exhibited widely, both nationally and internationally, in group and solo exhibitions, and he is a founding member of Network 11, which is a peer group of artists currently in residence at Cubic Gallery. And finally, we have Isaac Kariuki, who is a visual editor artist based in both London and in Nairobi. And his background is in digital arts. Have you actually completed your His work centres on themes of internet culture and nostalgia as it relates to marginalised identities. And as he mentioned, he's the founder of Diaspora Drama, which is a scene dedicated to creative and offbeat people of colour in cyberspace. So to you guys, and we'll start with Logo.
Like I introduced, my name is Logo Oluwamuyiwa, and I'm a photographer. I live and work in Lagos, Nigeria. In 2013, I started a digital archive of black and white photography on Lagos. Basically, the idea behind my work is I kind of wanted to express myself through different mediums. The first of them was poetry, and after a while, getting into the blow of how fast Lagos can get, I didn't get to write as much as I would, and I got into a small 2 weeks crash course in photography, and I decided to get a camera and photograph the things I would rather write about. After a while, it became too much on my computer, and I decided to show somebody or probably have a sense of what I was doing, if it made sense, or I was just boosting my own ego by myself. And I would read up on photographers in the past whose work have really made major impact in the world, like several photographers like Steve Leeds, Bruno Grant, Robert Frank, and all of those people, and how they've engaged with their spaces. And it made sense to me because I found their work very poetic, and I thought maybe I could do the same with Lagos. I don't know what you know about Lagos, but Lagos is probably different ideas to everybody, but it's the most populated city in Africa, and it's been photographed separately. I mean, there's a large creative database of work on Lagos, and I was thinking to myself, I was going to add to this existing database of work, what can I do differently?
I was just wondering whether maybe you could be mine, because lots of background noise.
All right.
To see if it works.
Hello? Yeah, it's working. Alright, so I was thinking maybe I could do something differently by trying to combine poetry and photography. And also, most importantly, I thought Lagos had been photographed separately from the color, especially the yellow buses, the chaos, the population, and all of these popular aesthetics that we probably know from the city. I was trying to, then it occurred to me after my familiarity with Robert Frank's work on America, and I thought, if I strip Lagos of its color, what would I find? Would Lagos lose its Lagosness, or would it become some type of ugly post-color photography type of city?
situation as some of my friends have described. And I started taking these black and white photographs in an attempt to write poetry on them later, or muse on them later, or just to create a type of archive to make myself feel good, like having very functional hobby. Then it filled up my computer, and I mean, you know the hard drive drama. So I started speaking with friends. I wasn't sure if there was a particular art scene or art community that I could relate with in particular. So I mean, for everybody in my generation, most likely, I turned online, and a friend told me about Tumblr and how it was a cool space for every creative energy that I had going on. So I started the Tumblr page or the blog, and I would upload this photograph with the fear that maybe somebody would lash out and tell me, hey, shit, shut down and stuff. But interestingly, I started to connect with different people from different parts of the world, and mostly, maybe because for a lot of them, they had lived in Lagos before, and it felt like a nostalgic type of feel for them. They were seeing places they had probably shared memories in, and or probably places they knew, and they were seeing differently from a black and white perspective. So I was getting emails, and you know how that thing can get, it starts to become like for an ego thing, and I kept on going on with the project, and ultimately it became like a large expanse digital archive of black and white photography, which I would lay on with my poetry or my writings. And I was doing this consciously, just sharing online, just constantly posting stuff at least 3 times daily. And I would rant and voice my agendas or opinion or whatever my mood was like for the day. But what was interesting was that it became a thing, like a very strong type of day for me, that it made me leave my job. And when I was going to leave my job, I started getting curious about maybe there was an art community I could show the work to that could give me a proper critique or tell me what I was doing right or wrong. And it was about that time I got introduced to an existing community called Art Scene in Nigeria. And but it was too late because I already had something going on online. And when I started showing my work, not a lot of people really could connect with it, but I found a place called the Center for Contemporary Art, CCA Yaba, in Lagos, Nigeria, and they had books that I'd read online that I was familiar with, and it was exciting to finally see those books in print. And so for me, I did not see any reason why I should show anybody anything anymore or ask for permission or validation if that's the word. So CCA became home and Tumblr became the office, you know what I mean? So I was sharing the work, and I was getting several emails from different parts of the world. I was getting a few blog posts, a few blog features. Interestingly, they did not have any idea what it looked like, because I wasn't really I'd never posted my own face. And I was getting comments on the writing, and it was the first time people were reading what I was writing. And I don't know if it was ego or I was enjoying myself, or it became some type of routine, but I like the fact that I was reaching out, connecting with artists from different parts of the world, from Spain to the UK to London to cross collaboration to the US rather. Interestingly, I started another platform for the work after Tumblr because I realized Tumblr folks were really artsy and we're all getting very grinding. I'm trying to connect my conversation to the reason why we're here. So I started Instagram on the other end to sort of give it like a very playful feel, since it was a share and go type of platform. And the interesting thing for Tumblr was it blew up in the country because a lot of the people in my city were really usually would like bent over their phones during the day. They were starting to recognize places that they were seeing on the page, and they were sending me messages like, hey, I saw the place you photographed yesterday. So it became like a 360 experience for the city residents, and for those that were living outside, they were telling me, whoa, I heard there was something in your city yesterday about some type of attack. How come we don't see this in your photograph? So that was the first time it occurred to me that I was telling a different story. Because initially it wasn't supposed to be like a statement of fact about the city, it was supposed to be like some type of study and see where I would go with it. And ultimately, to narrow down quickly, Tumblr got me my first exhibition, and what was what was surprising about the exhibition was I was being exhibited alongside people who had major experiences, who were like boss in the game, you know what I mean? And I walked into the gallery and it did not really, after 2 hours into the gallery show, it didn't really feel like the kind of stuff I wanted to do anymore, as much as I really wanted to showcase in the gallery and all of that. I kind of became that online friendly type of person, and but it was strong because for a lot of the visitors, I was new on the scene, they had no idea. They were asking me if I studied photography, or, which I didn't. For me, it was about looking for beauty in my city, in patterns, in forms, in perspective, and most importantly, trying to focus on the people and how they relate to the city, vice versa. For people that are familiar with Lagos, Lagos really has this very theatrical arrangement of everything, and that can really make some type of very strong visuals when you isolate individuals against this platform. But recently, it started to occur to me that by trying to tell the story of the city, I was basically telling my own story, because I had moved to the city to get a job and start a proper life, which is how things are in my country. But I was feeling a bit isolated, how I couldn't express myself or tell my craft or say the things I had going on. And online was my platform to vent, and one of the most impressive things that the online community did again was recently I started a digital photo book, because I figured, I mean, nobody was going to take my photos serious enough to write anything intellectual and possibly publish my work. So I thought, why not reach out to everybody that follows this project online? So I did an open call I just get these moments where I just post stuff, I just say, let's test the waters. I did an open call and I said I needed writers to look at the photographs and tell me how it resonated with them, that I was done right. I didn't like how it was just my words, and I got about 40 entries, and some guy reached out from Spain, Granada, and he told me I just graduated from School of Arts and Design and he was going to design the book. And that was massive for me, because this is somebody who had not been to Lagos before. And for me, that was a very strong use of the internet and how it has sort of like broken the boundaries and changed paradigms in how we deal with art and maybe African art, or if there's anything like that, which I don't really subscribe to. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Outside of, in a sense, through the fact that you get the sense that like all these works, you get the sense that there's something happening outside of the frame. In most of the videos, in most of the installations, one example of a piece is I had a watermelon and a bowling ball, and I made this whole series of works where one was trying to transform into the other, and vice versa. And so the video was cropped, so you only saw the action, but you had the sense that something was happening outside of the frame. And this has always been a particular point of interest to me, is not being able to be fixed. And I think that's just something that's I relate to within my own social experience, and also in terms of the fact that in terms of what influences you. So everything that I relate, everything that I put into work, titles, it reflects what I'm reading, and it reflects my own reality, in a sense. So I suppose I've come from a background where I was working from painting, shifted to sculpture, and now, you know, introducing things like, well, moving image has been something that I've been using for a few years now. Well, I'm introducing performance, and the biggest influence within the work is usually sound. So sound has a very huge role in this part, because of its parameters it can reach, and it's the sense of an echo and resonance, in a sense. And that distance it needs to have, the distance it needs sound for it to come back and relate to your work, or to you.
Was and what they wanted to talk about.
international exchange. Now, there are many people in this room that are engaged exactly in that. I'd love to hear your views on that. But let me just quickly point it to the artists. You all are, I'm sure, involved in various online platforms. Logo, you mentioned that you had a few that you talked about that you currently use, many of which I know nothing about, by the way. That's just me. But it seemed to me that within one of the communications revolution on the continent in Africa is very significant, particularly with mobile technology. I know in Kenya that's been a very, very big driver, artistically, but also in terms of the economy. Right? So people are using banking and other areas, but also artist networks. I guess my question initially, and I think Logo, you mentioned this in yours, is how have you managed to foster networks, contact with new audiences, perhaps, that you wouldn't necessarily done through coming to the gallery, but how has the online presence in these various social media and platforms, how has that kind of made a real difference to what you do? Not only in terms of the way you make art, perhaps, but in terms of how you communicate your practice, internationally.
Basically, for me, internet has always been a very strong part of my culture. I mean, the first platform popular on Facebook was used for quick reunions between old school mates and new friends that we're making online. And also, we're familiar with some wrong practices that the internet has been used for as well. But for me particularly, the difference we made was it was a quick access to talk to people you admire, and was also an access, like Isaac mentioned, there was no way to measure what you were doing, so you were not sure if you were doing it right or wrong, you were just putting it out there. So you allowed for freedom of some type of expression on the internet. And also, most importantly, you were getting raw comments. People were either not fair to you or they were slamming you down, and which would help you build some type of tough skin. It allowed you for vulnerabilities that you probably wouldn't be able to share on a day-to-day basis. So for me, that was the most important, because I wasn't particularly captioning the image in a very documentary fashion. They were obviously documentary photographs, which some of us could see, but I was laying them through my words, because some of these people are probably, some were taken from a distance, some I went close enough. Some told me stories that they were not sure they wanted me to share, maybe because of the vulnerability we shared. But for me, most importantly was about, I felt like art, when I started interacting with the art community, I was seeing a lot of tangible form of art, framed, and that was it. I didn't really know what was going on in the life of the artist. I didn't have an idea what their life was. There was no certain publication about them, and I didn't really like that, because I felt the two goes each other and goes with each other around. So I felt I could do that with the work. I wanted to share my work at the same time, let people see what the vibe was right and the vibe I was creating the work, whether good or bad, or after the show.
By the way, if you want to ask them any comment or ask a question, please raise your hand. I'll bring you in. Junior, now, your practice, as you say, involves number of different media. In your presentation, didn't you really specifically say how you engage with these online platforms? I wondered whether it does have, could you talk about, for example, your interest in what's beyond the frame, what's beyond the frame of the lens, what's beyond the frame of the here and now? And I wonder whether these online platforms might in some way enhance that, or that kind of, how have you kind of integrated it or not into your practice?
I mean, as I said, I've shifted towards, so my practice is very much hands-on previously, and I sort of work more towards a computer now, a sort of desk area. But I think it definitely has enhanced my work. I mean, most of the contact I have with people, they've seen work online, for instance, and it's a certain language thing that's online, when you communicate with people, that it's not the same when you're face to face. It's not better, it's not worse, it's different. That I think is, like, quite recently I've just connected with for the network project, connected with a writer called Lewis Shortsucker. And when I approached him, it was just a case of just emailing. His contact was when he worked in university, and I just approached, you know. His work was online that I found, you know, all his essays are there. I don't know where he gets, you know, where he gets the money from it, but it's available. Because there's not a certain language you have, so you end up being a bit more relaxed and you find your own approach to this contact. And yeah,
sure.
So, Kenzie?
Yeah, one of the things I thought would be great to hear from you, Junior, and because we have Evan here as well, thinking about that relationship between kind of physical real world networks and the online digital networks, is to think about how Network 11 as a network has kind of impacted you both as artists. So I'm working in Evan here as well. But just to get that contrast and perspective about how that came about, and
Okay, yeah.
Maybe Junior, you
want to
respond, and then Evan can come in as well.
Maybe we want to say a quick word about people that know what Network 11 is.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. So, group of artists, we're all London-based black artists, but we're trying to deal with work beyond the act of making and trying to find new models.
I guess one of the questions is, like, why was it important for that to be a physical group and network that you meet in the real world? You know, now we have these digital platforms, so why was it important for you to do that? Or, you know, what's the, maybe you can contrast in that way or say something about it?
Yeah, I mean, I'm obviously coming in. I mean, just to kind of go, just to carry on with what you were saying, is the idea behind the network was this, starting point of being black artists, but thinking about, or kind of, you know, engaging with the history and the legacies of black art and thinking about what is it that brings our practices together beyond our blackness. You know what I mean? And so we've tried to create these kind of discursive spaces, which, in a way they can exist online, but really there's something, I think, about being able to be in a space together that creates or allows for a certain kind of conversation to happen. And so it really is about kind of creating space to think through our practices, and to, but not only just look at the work, but think about the stuff that kind of impacts and influences the work.
Yeah.
So, you know, like you inviting Lewis, and, you know, when I did my session, I also Skyped in somebody. So it's also this idea of kind of exploring the network that we have between us, but then also the networks that we're connected to outside of our network.
I suppose, if you're dealing with when you talk about online, I mean, Facebook, like, I think like the guy who created Facebook is like, he's almost like exactly the same age as me. And so, like, you know, I grew up in this sort of time, I suppose, where things are all, I've been in a generation, I suppose, people like early 30s, that just, when things, technology has been changing, always has moved with it. You know, like Facebook, I suppose, when it started as this very social thing with your friends, now it's become quite a thing that you use for work, essentially. Not really, it's not really a social network for me anyway. It's more a online connection. And so through that, I've made contact with many artists in the continent, particularly from Ghana, because I go there quite regularly. So I'm always like, oh, if I go there, you know, how am I going to reach out? I would like to meet up some more artists. So yeah.
Can I, if I may, start to try and point out for people, so I can be an evil chair.
I just wanted to invite everyone to feel free to stand up and have some drink.
Absolutely, yes. So please, as we discuss, grab some drink and stuff. But I wanted to actually point to Alessio and to who is director of Gasworks and Triangle, which is a major international, transnational network of artist residencies, production, with links across the world. Including in Kenya and other places in the continent. And I wanted to bring you in here, Alessio, just to kind of, I guess your network, Triangle Network, you know, is very famous for fostering kind of face-to-face residencies, meetings, contacts, exhibitions, etc. So I wondered, what role does online networking, online presence, social media platforms play in what you are doing? Has it changed the way that Triangle work?
I agree. Triangle has been around since 1982, so it's like 34, 35 years almost. And when it first started, there was no such thing as the online. So actually, it was the sort of opportunity for people to find out what was happening outside the mainstream around the world. So in places that were sort of LA, New York, London, and I don't know, Zurich or wherever. And so it had that role of actually sort of connecting places that otherwise would be so outside the sort of map that was in the mainstream that nobody would know it ever existed. But things have changed dramatically as a result of the internet and, of course, as a result of these platforms. And one of the things that Triangle did in the early 2000s was to, for example, raise a lot of funding from the Ford Foundation so that each partner within the network got their own website. Mm-hmm. And in fact, many of those websites have now disappeared, lost, they've become redundant, and of course, people use that platform. But it was very significant, the beginning of 2000, precisely because all of a sudden, all these places that people would not know or claim they would know would suddenly be accessible. Of course, the internet isn't accessible everywhere, and we know this, but I'm talking in general terms. So I think the digital platforms have had a tremendous role in partners being able to speak for themselves and not to have everything centralized. So it actually made the network much more what it is, which is a group of people that are very independent or a group of organizations that are independent coming together with a common philosophy rather than having always to go through a spokesperson because that's the one that is in London or the one that has the resources or all of that. And it's still changing now. I think it's actually created, which is the reason why I thought this talk was interesting for us, mm-hmm. It's actually created a moment of crisis for Triangle, mm-hmm. because at the beginning we knew what our role was, which was sort of like create visibility mm-hmm. where the majority of the world would try not to look at. Whereas now Google's doing all of that, so to speak. So what is Triangle here to do? And we're actually in the process of reassessing that and thinking how that is actually supporting Triangle to move to the next step. But just before I finish, it was interesting. We We've been a network for many years, and I've been working for it for 18 years now, so a long time. But after having had communications through emails or through phone calls and all these things, we organized a conference in London in 2011, and you were part of it, to some extent, in some of the conversations. And that bringing all of the networks together in one room did the work that we were trying to do by emails for years, which goes back to what you guys were saying about being Londoners and connecting to the internet, but the necessity to actually see each other. It totally makes sense to me, because I think it's not one or another, but it's how together they create much more and you can produce so much more. So that conference, which is 5 years ago, it's still a moment in the life of Triangle that has 30 years, where everyone was all in one room and we were shouting at each other, and that was amazing, because we could see each other face to face. And it wasn't like a spokesperson, or it wasn't sort of like, oh, I can't hear you, okay, you go off and somebody else has a better connection, has more voice. We were just all very much playing field. And so that's why I think it's interesting how there can be a synergy between all these different modalities.
Sure, thank you. Isaac, can I just come to you? Because quite interested in the way, in terms of your practice, you're also an online journal or magazine. I just wondered how that was kind of fostering new audiences. And what kinds of audiences do you think you're communicating with in that kind of? Because the question of audience, not only for the artists, but also for institutions and for practitioners, is quite important. Not the important opportunity that the online presences do afford. So I was wondering, maybe tell us a little bit more about how you're engaging these audiences through what's the name of your journal?
Diaspora
Drama. I think it's a really interesting title. There's a lot of drama in diaspora. I wonder how you're dealing with that drama. What kinds of conversations are being afforded by that kind of online platform?
So the title actually came because I looked up diaspora on the top on Tumblr, and just a lot of very depressing poetry to do with trees and just branches. And I thought that's a very legitimate thing to talk about, because I'm in a diaspora community, can be very depressing, but also we have a very fun side to us and a very comedic and upbeat side to us, and that's what I wanted to showcase. So in terms of our audience, it's mostly, I'd say how the scene has been shared through a lot of people who want to get into art but they don't understand the language of art scene or writing or something. So they do understand mysticals on BuzzFeed, instead of top 10 artists, but that's a very good introduction. If you just want to get into art and don't really want to hassle a lot of the job and the rest of your art. So that's a very, and I really like the audience, because there are people who not necessarily fit into the world, but do still make art for them, for people like them as well. But that's the number one thing to be sharing. And I feel like the internet is kind of an equalizer, because everyone's work will always be at the same level, no matter how many followers or whatever you have, it's still be different. If you post your work on Instagram, it's the same as a huge artist posting. So it doesn't matter if you're talking with the artists, and the audience you reach really just matters in what your art communicates, if they like it or not.
Can I hit you again in the Nick here? Nick, I'm bringing Nick because Nick is the librarian at England, which is the Institute for International Visual Arts, which has a significant online. Logo mentioned, I think you mentioned your presentation, about the idea of having an archive of your practice in some way. Right, so the online presents archival opportunities, right? It's an opportunity to have an archive of your work. That's a very practical issue. Now, Nick, you are presiding over and developing a very important archive of culturally diverse arts practice, global arts practice at Inver. And I'm wondering maybe if you could just speak a little bit to how Inver also dealt with the challenge of online and social media and how that's connected with your work. Has that opportunity, have you been able to foster new audiences through that?
Absolutely. So maybe just to sort of talk about what we call the system is that from Innovers started in 1994, so it's in its infancy, and there's this physical archive of primarily ephemera and things like that, just statements, slides, press releases, these sorts of things, a very kind of wide array of artists, many of whom probably wouldn't have had websites at that stage. Frankly, interestingly, has to develop it through things like printouts and screen captures of the kind of previous stage. And this was kind of, at that moment, I don't think there's anything really quite like it in terms of capturing a lot of artistic practice from both quite established artists, but particularly emerging, particularly black British artists, and depending on the selection of background. Later on in the library and the archive's existence, we then thought it was important to engage and make this available digitally, and some funding was found to develop this into a digital archive. But the physical documents were still the foundation of this, so we created just a very simple online database of artists, writers, curators, and it would be partially digitalized physical documents, but just a little small amount of biographical information. And again, this was a very significant resource, and to this day, there isn't really much that compares with it. I think the only thing that I can think of is really Eddie Chambers' website, New Diaspora Artists. One thing I would say about actually the kind of the history of how these things evolved, though, you get project funding to create a digital resource of that nature. You don't. It's very, very hard to attract funding to sustain it. So the way that these things are updated, if you look at lots of people's biographies, they're massively out of date. The way that it continues to develop, really, it's just artists that we're working with very directly. So it doesn't. It's maybe lost some of the original dynamism. That was available when we were collecting physical material in that way, and we're still collecting both. It's an archive and library as well, and I think it's very important that we can build up these physical collections and continue to promote them. And similarly, to what Alessio was saying, I really don't see it as a tension between the kind of physical and the digital in lots of different ways, but I think, you know, every physical library has an online library catalog to point to things. The Google Books helps you find out things. So again, Eddie James' recent book, Project Some British Art, that's available, the entirety of it, on Google Books for text. You can't, the kind of, it's a rights management control, so you can't access all of it. But you can very quickly see if any artist mentioned in it, and then refer back to the book and find out how many resources. Here, or go to the Central Collection in Chelsea as well to find out further. And then just to come back to the artists here, I was very interested in the different ways that, that all three of you engage with the digital and the physical. That's a drama, something we're a big fan of, we have a collection. But I'm very interested in that, that you're interested in that kind of, that you choose to self-publish this. It's very much in that zine edition rather than a kind of all zine. Something slides were from one of my clients as well, and that seems like something very important to you. Rather than, and you were similarly, and Logo were not wanting to, do a kind of physical photo book, a glossy monograph in the same way.
What I was trying to explain is that. As at the time of the work, I was not sure if I would find opportunities to publish because I mean, it was just 4 years in, 2013, so I was really doubting if I would be able to convince a publisher or convince writers at that level to write about my photographs. So I figured, I mean, if I was disseminating online, maybe I might as well just build something digitally since it's cheaper and almost controllable within resources I had. That was why I explored that option. So it wasn't an anti-agenda.
Well, that's what I find.
democracy consensus emerging. The online, thank you. I was thinking of doing very much to kind of like shake this up a little bit. But there's a kind of collective consensus emerging, and I'm going to go to that in one second, about online. It's a good thing, you know, it helps, it's kind of fosters communities, it helps the artists. But I guess I'd like to kind of think about what the challenges and what are the downsides of that. I'm not sure, Les, you were going to.
Well, I was going to sort of go through that.
Do you want to say a little bit about, because you've got an interesting.
I was part of UK 89, and I've been living in Melbourne, Australia since then. I was involved in a volunteer exhibition in Brixton in 1984. One that was curated by Russia. And my work, both my painting and my writing, is based on diaspora politics. So I'm sort of interested in, you know, we didn't have like words like kind of relationality in those days. Mm-hmm. It was pre-postmodernism. However, I forget your name now.
Evan. Yeah.
When Evan was talking about engaging in new ways and histories and legacies, that's kind of what I'm interested in. I'm interested in how that these new platforms have been impacted upon how you engage with the histories and the legacies.
Mm.
And that's really what I'm interested in, because I've got a handle on what happened in the 80s and 90s.
Mm.
And I want to find out whether, for instance, the old opposition politics of those days are relevant now. If so, what parts? And I know it's going to be a complex story. It's not one thing or the other. And I think in online digital, is probably one of the main factors in actually impacting on that discourse.
Yeah, that's a very good point. I think a lot of, obviously, there's quite a lot, but not, there needs to be more material around that period. There's a lot of that stuff that's coming up online. I'm sure a lot of the younger artists that doesn't look at that, engage with it, question it, want to see how relevant it is. Evan, I know you're very much better at this.
Yeah. the whole online thing. I'm a little bit more critical, I think, because I'm a Christian Nation Junior I've actually found this funny because some of the stuff you're saying, Isaac, about things being misnamed and misquoted is actually something I found with my work online. Because in the past I have put a lot of it online and I will find people like screen grabbing certain things or posting about certain things, and it will be completely framed incorrectly, which is why actually I'm starting to disappear from the online, because I'm just fed up. I'm fed up with how I'm seeing my work when actually I put it on there because I want it to be accessible, because I am trying to have a transnational global conversation, but then actually I'm finding it gets completely decontextualized, and I just got a bit fed up. So there's that, and also kind of seeing a lot of content that is coming up, there is this kind of sense that I'm the first person to do this. It's like, but actually, if you look into the archives, you see that actually it's already been done, it's already been happening, and it would be a lot more useful to stop this whole we are innovators and actually think, how are we in relation to what happened before? Which is exactly what something like the network is about.
Yeah.
No, and I think it's something that happens online. There's this feeling that actually I must have been the first person to do it, when actually a lot of the time you just
were. For me, I would say online is a place where you can see, you don't have to feel that way.
Mm.
You have this sense that if there's something I feel is obscure, it exists, rather than it's this platform which it can exist, rather than where do you begin? There might have been a time I wouldn't know.
Potentiality.
Yeah, because I
use that.
Yeah, I mean, I mean, most people, when they're looking for certain things, they go straight online, they type in.
But then what about the stuff that isn't online? Because it hasn't been archived, you know, because it hasn't been digitized or whatever. You know, it's not the material isn't there, but because of the ease of access that you're presenting the things that you can see online, people don't go and look deeper or look elsewhere.
Some
you know
people.
What I mean? And so, yeah, some people, and well, I know that's not everybody, because of course I'm not one of those people, you know, but just for a lot of the stuff I'm seeing, for me, it can feel a bit lazy at times. And then also, you know, there's also the fact that, yeah, okay, there's people like Eddie's archive, but then there's also Rebecca Himmins' archive. You know, there's also the Make History Visible, there's also the Women of Colour Index. Because ultimately, for me, a lot of the time, women feel pretty invisible. Case in point, you know, I appreciate what's happening, but why are there women on this panel? You know what I mean? And it's like, even you mentioned these archives, but actually there's two really important archives set up by women. You know what I mean? It's like, why is it always
there?
I was telling Junior when I met him that I knew your work way back 2013 before I met
you. Yeah, because that's it. It's been online for a while.
I knew your work from probably a different context, maybe from the screen grabbing and the old ideas. But one thing is for sure. One thing is for sure, the way I kind of perceive art and the way I think it's shifted is that when you create something, whether art or a product or anything, it's open to perception of your idea. And the moment you put it out, whether in a book or in a library or online, it will be misinterpreted or accepted, and that you cannot obviously control most of the time. You cannot, and also in terms of authorship, which you also mentioned. I mean, you're putting out so much work, and you're scared that maybe someone will just grab a couple of folders and group present as that. It also makes you put you on your toes as an artist. You get what I mean? You're dealing with a very rushing tide, and you're consciously reminding yourself: should I work harder, such that I have a strong stamp on this platform that is so open, such that if anybody sees my work. If I'm not there, somebody will defend me. That puts you on the toes and that makes you work hard. And in the context of representation, I mean, asking for female players in the game, the truth is the online has actually opened up more interactions and more participation than the libraries and the archives would. Because now, nobody's open to ask for questions and answers. Everybody's just putting out the stuff, not based on gender, just based on inspiration.
But then, like you said, people are putting out the stuff, and you know what you said with your, actively sort out critique and discourse, because actually putting out the images is not enough. You know, but, and that's what I'm talking about, it's lazy. You know, like, the images are out there, but actually, where's the conversation? Where's the discourse? You know what I mean? Where does it actually become something other than just, you know, just a proliferation of images?
Yeah, it becomes
that's
personal. It becomes personal. Conversation and the discourse becomes personal.
You know
it becomes
the
image.
No, it's not personal, it's just
assumption.
Not asking.
That's an assumption that's most people have like a personal mind and much like.
No, I'm not talking about intellectual discourse, I'm just talking about a conversation. It doesn't have to be, it does not about like kind of creating, you know, high theory.
I think kind of what we're talking about really is because the thing about the internet and online presents itself as a kind of a given, right? It's out there, how do we interact with it? It's there, right? The question is, how do we engage it? What kind of politics do we want to engage with? How do we want to engage it aesthetically and politically? And that's the kind of question that I think I'm asking. I think Len's kind of hinting at that in terms of some of the radical politics that came out of the 80s, right? There's an assumption that the internet is, as I said, it's this kind of consensus, right? It's great. But that's, you know, on the other hand, you know, we do, it doesn't fully do the politics for you. The politics is something that has done, okay, in that conversation. Let's widen the conversation about
I think you just said before, I was going to touch upon, but I think it's the infrastructure that everybody seems to be looking for, and a space for discourse, the platform that we have been talking about, the Facebooks, the Instagrams, the Tumblrs, these are not necessarily platforms where those conversations can happen easily, or platforms that want those conversations to happen. So it's, again, it's exactly as you said, how do you engage with politics on the internet, how do you create that space?
One of the other things I think, and this relates to
think everyone's practice, all the practices here around tech performance. Performance is interesting, right? Because in some respects, and it's maybe more fashion evidence, please correct me, but the, following the kind of Peggy Thielen kind of notion of performance happening in the moment, right? The specificity of performance, the power of performance, is that it happens here and now, and it's about communication with us now. But how does the internet change that? The internet challenges the ontology, the being of performance, right? So Evan's videos are circulating online. How does that take away not only not the ownership question, but in terms of what performance is and what the potential political relational aspects of performance? Do you know what I'm saying? So it's interesting to see how I think one of the questions that is emerging is how does online change the nature of art practice, the nature of aesthetic experience? How do we experience art? How do we engage with art? Yeah. You know, and I think it's an open question. I think it's there to be shaped by how we engage with it.
And I feel like the immediate response for me would be the question of feedback. Because if you're having a live performance, okay, you might not get, you know, there might be conversations to a certain degree afterwards, but you're gonna get a physical response. You know what I mean? You're gonna get a sense from the audience about how we're engaging with your work. It could be that everybody's left, or it could be that there's an applause, you know what I mean? There's gonna be some kind of there's gonna be some kind of feedback. Whereas with the internet, it is become more difficult, I think. And yeah, okay, you know, there's lights and there's retreats and there's all of that kind of stuff. But what does that actually mean in terms of actually kind of productive, you know, kind of generating something? I don't know, for me, just that stuff is not enough. You know what I mean? Like, the clickbait stuff is not enough. You know, it's, so this question is, can we get it?
Yeah, it can be too easy.
Yeah.
Can I, if I may, ask Mr. Asimoto a question? I know Leo is looking at me like, why is he talking? But the reason why I'm pointing at Mr. Asimoto, Leo Asimoto has been working on a very wide-ranging, quite important project called the ONS Project, which is dealing with issues of culture, technology, history, through a variety of media involving photography, films, making objects. But why I'm asking you, Leo, what I'm trying to get from you is because the combination of this project, which has been going for many years, it's been shown around the country and internationally, it's been asking very important questions around the history of how Benin, where Leo's from in Nigeria, the history of Benin, how it relates to British history, etc. But the point is, why I'm mentioning this is because the combination of this project will be a performance. It will be kind of an act which you would have to experience here and now. And I'm just wondering, Leo, how these kinds of network questions that we're discussing here might impact on your idea of how you will work with, you know, delivering this kind of important combination to your work, if that makes, any sense.
I think the come from what you're concerned about, not to be very specific. It's what do you see at points that I stage in a particular given place? What do you see there or transmitted online? That also is very specific. That's where you choose to see it. But I'll take it to performance within a project, begin with the British performances, which was very specific in the sense where it was specific to the radio station, where it was created and transmitted. But where the work is experienced was very specific. So the idea of the internet or the notion of transmission, what I sort of enjoyed about that particular moment in the project was being site-specific is not necessarily what you have to be able to see it. When you do something in a random way, it carries on in each stage of the project. And then you then look at the recording of these performances, which for me is very separate from the performance and has a different title altogether. Mm-hmm. And those recordings, as it were, talk about retain memory of it through that recording, but a lot of these are also pretty much copies. So what I'm enjoying the way is that this specifically occupation of work is very important to the project, as well as the material I use to make performances. The experience of it is very central to that moment in time. But its transmission is also where it decides to see whether they're home, what you're doing there. It also has to speak to that audience members. So I have no qualms with any of it. Just more of transmission.
Okay. Before I come to you, we've got about 5 minutes left to round up the conversation. I think, I think there were challenges. I think there's kind of, we heard from the artist, the importance of engaging with these networks, but there are also challenges. I'm going to ask Paula to come in, and maybe Hansi might want to kind of bring in the perspective of Future Assembly as well. And then we are then pleased to welcome you to come have some drinks and maybe to continue the conversation informally for 20 minutes or so, and then we'll boot you out for half eight at the start when we go home and wipe up our get up in the neck. So, Paula, to you.
Yes. I think probably this is a question most specifically for Isaac. I think it's been a really interesting conversation talking about online and offline. But I keep thinking about whether there is any special or more urgent or more something more imperative about having kind of this kind of online platform or network or space for diaspora artists. So bringing it back to the idea of diaspora and transnational conversation. And I suppose, Isaac, because you're from Kenya, but you're based in London, so I suppose you could epitomize that, the kind of the best. Do you feel either that it is, the internet has been beneficial in that regard, or I suppose is it a burden as well at the same time, having this kind of having to fit into a kind of a concept of being part of diaspora?
Well, actually, as much as I've been defending the internet, I still find it a very hostile space for non-Western users. Mm. If I Google something, the first of these 5 pages will all be English, and if my language isn't in like the index for like on Google, I can't bother with it. So I've always found it very difficult when, let's say, there's an article about me on the internet, I can't really share it with my relatives back home. So that's something that's very restrictive about the internet. And if I, let's say, I want to have a domain and make my own online gallery, I want to be all Kenyan. It can't be because all the like domain and servers belong to like Australia or like America and companies or whatever. So there's always going to be a restriction when it comes to me as a non-Western artist trying to make work under like a huge umbrella of just like Western influences and like and basically using the tools of Western spirit for it. And so I've always enjoyed my experiences most of the time having my work out there, especially interacting with a lot of diaspora and most of the international artists on the internet who share similar experiences with me, and that's a very easy way to find people like you. And sorry to like go back further into the discussion, but I find like even though it's a this like typically articles about like top 5 African artists, that's a very easy way to find someone. And artists you can relate to, even though, yeah, it'll be a summary of their work, it's not really encapsulated their work, and that's what going on their website is for, that's what looking at their YouTube and looking at interviews with them, that's what that's for. My experiences with the internet and finding people on it have been very beneficial, and been very beneficial for other artists as well.
Sorry, just to put you in, top question mentioned creative possibilities and collaborations, and drawing from what you just said, I find it pretty contrasting to what I think, because it is an IP domain that is domiciled in Australia and America, Doesn't that open up opportunities for you to collaborate with tech folks from Kenya who can walk around these opportunities and probably find it?
But the problem will be that I still have to go back to the service back in the US.
No, I don't necessarily agree. I think it opens opportunities for newer practices. Like I said, it makes you stay ahead of your tools, you get what I mean? Which is why I enjoy about the internet, because everything you find that is not working, it gives you alternatives to think about how you can make it work. I mean, you try to create a domain platform. One thing happened one time in Lagos, Nigeria. They were trying to create a system where they were going to teach kids different languages, but they had no platform online that had local languages. 6 months down the line, some guy that was sitting in the conference while this was discussed created a platform that domiciled local languages in less than 6 months. If that issue was not brought up, there won't be a solution. Which is why I think the internet gives room for it. The moment you find the problem, it makes you want to think about looking for solutions, which I think it's what we should really hold on to.
Yeah, I agree with you, but there's also some people who would not necessarily want to be the first ones to do something like that. I mean, I know it's a very maybe a selfish idea to think that, I'll wait for someone else to do it. But I'm thinking about it, let's say someone who has social anxiety who needs to actually start homebrewing that to actually interact with people who didn't ever actually interact with before. So that's what I'm thinking about.
Thank you. So before we close, I'd like to give opportunity for anyone else who hasn't spoken yet, if they've got any questions or comments before we round up the conversation. Anyone wanted to make any more final comments?
Okay, Hansi, do you want to?
One of the things that I think is important for me, I'm really interested that we explore this idea of the digital, but I actually don't want to set up a kind of false dichotomy between digital and physical world platforms. I think we perhaps all feel that they are interlinked and can support each other in different ways. And one of the things that's key, I think, for future assembly is thinking about how can we support artists to connect and network and to actually use platforms, whether real or digital, to actually create peer-to-peer learning networks and conversations, no matter where they are based. So that's kind of where this idea of the transnational or continental diaspora comes in. So that's one of the key questions I think that we'll continue to explore through future assembly is, how can we support artist practice, how can we support dialogue between places, and whether that's online or through physical, tapping into physical networks. So, yeah, I hope to be more welcome
on
that, and thank you all.
Great. Well, then, the last thought I'm leaving, in terms of planning the conversation, I think, for me, where I'm at the internet anyway, the value to networks, is that it's very much a double-edged sword. Right? And I would point to, next door there's a film released, which I think is a really good example, because on the one hand, that is a really, I haven't seen it yet, but from what I've read about it, it's a really innovative, creative tour de force that deals with the perspective of black women in terms of struggles around black women within the States and linking it to all kinds of radical black politics, which is kind of quite rare to have that kind of conversation on a global platform. But on the other hand, it's being done through a very tightly orchestrated strategy by Beyoncé and Jay-Z through Tidal, which is only available on Tidal, which happens to be our husband's global internet network, which, So, you know what I'm saying? But just what I'm trying to say is, on the one hand, she's dealing with really progressive, important issues around social change, feminism, black women. But she's doing it through, very corporate, transnational.
Well, that's a whole
other thing. It is. The point
capitalist sense, but it is a, you know, either way, the politics that we, every one of us, have to develop to engage this becomes all the more important.
Yeah, and let's not follow Beyonce's example in terms of politics, because it's flawed.
Yes. It's no good question. So I'd like to thank you all for coming. I'd like to thank the artists for their presentations, and also congratulations on seeing your work, and we look forward to seeing more of your work. And also to Hansi and Walla for organising this and bringing in fresh perspectives into training, which I really appreciate. So please, for the next 20 some minutes, have some drinks, wine, and